On a hot afternoon in May 2016, 5 miles outside the young petro city of Fort McMurray, Alberta, a small wildfire flickered and ventilated, rapidly expanding its territory through a mixed forest that hadn't seen fire in decades. This fire had started out doing what most human-caused wildfires do in their first hours of life, working its way tentatively through grass and dead leaves, a fire's equivalent to baby food. These fuels, in combination with the weather, would determine what kind of fire this was going to be, a creeping ground-level smolder doomed to smother in the heavy dew of a cool and windless spring night, or something bigger, more durable and dynamic, a fire that could turn night into day and day into night, that could, unchecked and all-consuming, bend the world to its will. It was early in the season for wildfires, but first responders were shocked by what they saw. By the time a helicopter with a water bucket got over it, the smoke was already black and seething, a sign of unusual intensity. The fire grew from 4 acres to 150 in 2 hours. Its rapid growth coincided with a rash of broken temperature records across the North American subarctic that peaked at 33 degrees Celsius on May 3rd, in a place where temperatures are typically between 15 and 20 Celsius. Then, a smoke and wind-suppressing inversion lifted, winds whipped up to 20 knots, and a monster leaped across the Athabasca River. Within hours, Fort McMurray was overtaken by a regional apocalypse that drove serial firestorms through the city from end to end for days. Entire neighborhoods burned to their foundations beneath a towering pyrocumulus cloud typically found over erupting volcanoes. This fire-driven weather system generated hurricane-force winds and lightning that ignited still more fires many miles away. Nearly 100,000 people were forced to flee a suddenly annihilating world where fists of heat pounded on windows and the sky rained fire. The fire's toll conjured images of a nuclear blast. There was not just damage, there was total obliteration. It had belched 100 million tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, much of it from burning cars and houses. And it burned for months, not declared fully extinguished until August the following year. Wildfires live and die by the weather. But the weather doesn't mean the same thing it did in 1990, or even a decade ago. And the reason the Fort McMurray fire drew international attention was not only because of its size and ferocity, but also because it was a direct hit on the epicenter of Canada's multi-billion-dollar petroleum industry. That industry and this fire represent supercharged expressions of two trends that have been marching in lockstep for the past century and a half. Together, they embody the spiraling synergy between the headlong rush to exploit hydrocarbons at all costs and the corresponding increase in heat-trapping greenhouse gases that is altering our atmosphere in real time. In the spring of 2016, the hottest year in recorded history, a new kind of fire introduced itself to the world.
"No one's ever seen anything like this," said Fort McMurray's exhausted fire chief. "The way this thing happened, the way it traveled, the way it behaved, this is rewriting the book."
Canada contains 10% of the world's forests, vast tracts of which are uninhabited. But vast is an ineffective descriptor up here, in the landlocked subarctic. Things seem to occur in outsized dimensions. Lakes can be the size of inland seas, with trout which can weigh 45 kilograms. In Wood Buffalo National Park is the world's largest known beaver dam. Spotted in 2007 with the aid of a satellite, it's more than twice as long as the Hoover Dam, and it appears to be growing. One exception to this are the trees, which seldom exceed 60 feet in height or 100 years in age.
These woods of pine, spruce, aspen, poplar, and birch are known as the boreal forest. Girdling the northern hemisphere in a circumpolar band, it is the largest terrestrial ecosystem, comprising almost a third of the planet's total forest area. As densely wooded as the boreal might appear, it is something far more amphibious, containing more sources of fresh water than any other biome. It resembles a kind of hemispheric sponge that happens to be covered in trees, their billions of miles of roots weaving the continents together in a subterranean warp and weft. In spite of all that water, these trees are designed to burn down on a regular basis. The circumboreal is truly a phoenix among ecosystems. Reborn in fire, it must incinerate in order to regenerate, and it does so in its random patchwork fashion every 50 to 100 years. This colossal biome stores as much, if not more, carbon than all tropical forests combined, and when it burns, it goes off like a carbon bomb. Fort McMurray is an anomaly in North America. Located 600 miles south of the Arctic Circle, the city is an island of industry in an ocean of trees. Without the lure of petroleum, this part of Alberta would resemble Siberia even more than it already does. But in 2016, Fort McMurray and its satellite communities were home to an international population of nearly 90,000 people, living in buildings ranging from trailer homes to McMansions and high-rise concrete apartments. Canada is the world's fourth largest oil producer, and almost 90% originates in Fort McMurray. In terms of overtime logged and dollars earned, it is without a doubt the hardest working, highest paid municipality on the continent. Fort McMurray has earned several nicknames, and one of them is Fort McMoney. May 3, 2016 began differently for everyone, but in Fort McMurray, it ended the same. Certainly, it was a little early for fires. There were still car-sized blocks of ice on the riverbanks, and some lakes had yet to thaw, but otherwise this was nothing new. Fires cloud the horizon every spring and summer. Smoke is simply a feature of the boreal landscape. But in the forest, out of sight, things were changing. Winter snowfall had been far below average 2 years running, and leaves crackled underfoot as if it were late summer. Given the unseasonable heat and the fact that five separate wildfires ignited around the city that weekend, it's hard to overstate how unconcerned Fort McMurray's citizenry was. Fort McMurray is a one-industry town. That industry revolves around bitumen, its recovery, upgrading, and transport. A bitumen mine is not a place you would let your child play, but it's excavated using equipment familiar to any four-year-old conversant in Tonka technology and with a similar grandiosity of ambition. To access the bitumen, the forest above it must first be removed. This living material is referred to as overburden, and the machine used to scrape it off is a Caterpillar D11 bulldozer. This weighs more than 100 tons, and its blade is 22 feet wide. It plows down a forest like mowing a lawn. Once the forest has been removed, enormous electric shovels excavate the bituminous sand in boulder-sized chunks that occasionally contain complete dinosaur fossils from the Cretaceous period. These garage-sized loads are dumped into a Caterpillar T797 hauler, which is 3 stories tall and weighs 400 tons, unloaded. There are hundreds of machines like this operating in the mines north of Fort McMurray. Far too large for ordinary highways, the tires alone are 13 feet tall and cost $85,000 apiece. When one of them catches on fire, something that happens more often than one might expect due to the terrific friction their loads generate, it must be deflated from a safe distance with a rifle bullet. Should one of these 6-ton tires explode on its own, it will impact its surroundings like a powerful bomb. The hauler's job is to carry the raw bituminous sand over to the crusher, a kind of mechanical black hole with two gigantic, continuously turning studded cylinders, which, one employee told me, can consume a city bus in 3 seconds. The environment these behemoths are currently dismantling is an ice-bound netherworld. Mile upon mile of black and ransacked earth, pocked with stadium-swallowing pits, dead, discolored lakes, flaming stacks, and fuming refineries. The whole laced together by mazes of dirt roads and piping, patrolled by building-sized machines that, enormous as they are, appear dwarfed by the wastelands they have made. There's no place for the toxic effluent to go except into the soil or the air, or, if one of the massive earthen dams should fail, into the Athabasca River. For decades, cancer rates have been abnormally high in the downstream communities. Even people gainfully employed in the mines compare them to Mordor. Like an ancient temple complex, bright yellow ziggurats of solid sulfur bigger than the pyramids at Giza, and 600-foot flare stacks were the tallest man-made things for 1,000 miles in any direction. At this scale, humans simply disappear. The last time bitumen built a city the size of Fort McMurray was about 3,000 years ago in Babylon. Despite the twin chasms of time and geography separating that ancient Mesopotamian capital from this postmodern North American boomtown, their street plans are surprisingly similar. Attenuated gridworks flanking the left banks of their local rivers. Over the course of 2 millennia, several sackings, and a handful of dynasties, bitumen literally bound Babylon together from the ground up. It mortared the ancient urban center's great concentric walls, dozens of feet high and miles long. It underpinned an extensive road network, and it sealed elaborate canal systems, some of which survive to this day. Like its more refined successors, this rudimentary petroleum facilitated ambition on unprecedented scales. A brief sampling includes the Gates of Ishtar, Emperor Nebuchadnezzar's Hanging Gardens, and the 30-story Tower of Babel. Without bitumen, these quasi-mythical megaprojects might never have been built, and nor would Fort McMurray's modern equivalent, the enormous and gleaming quarter-billion-dollar pleasure palace that is the Suncor Community Leisure Center. This is, in its way, a Babel too. In 2016, the census identified 80 first languages spoken in Fort McMurray and its surrounding worksites, and all of them can be heard in the pools, weight rooms, and saunas, or on the courts, rinks, and curling sheets of the Suncor Leisure Center. In this way, Fort McMurray represents what is arguably the most remote melting pot on Earth, for humans and fossil fuels alike. But if Babylon was a center surrounded by other powerful centers, Fort McMurray is the end of the road. The sole purpose of this road, in effect a dead-end superhighway, is its access to bitumen. A fire's beginnings are always humble and depend on a tripod of factors, over which, at first anyway, it has no control: heat, fuel, and oxygen. A fourth ingredient, a catalyst, is then needed to unite these disparate elements into a dynamic whole. Frankenstein's monster needed a jolt of lightning, and so in its way does fire. Under the right conditions, a cigarette, a domestic gas leak, even static electricity from a house cat can set it off. But ignition isn't the true moment of origin. This falls to the chemical reaction that precedes it. It is not the tree or house that burns, but the gases those things emit. This is what heat is for, to liberate flammable gases from their solid or liquid prisons by transforming them into vapor. In fire's world, everything relevant is breathing, emitting, vaporizing, volatile. Not just the air, but trees, the house, the countertop, the bag of cat food sitting on it. The higher the temperature, the broader fire's menu. Under the right conditions, even a bulldozer will burn. Just as we cook food to release its nutrients, fire cooks its fuel. And just as a compelling scent draws a bloodhound through the woods, so volatile gases draw fire. In this sense, fire is pulled through space. Here, in the invisible gaseous interface between the thing and its ignition, fire becomes mobile. This molecule-thin frontier, known as the reaction zone, enables or denies, from moment to moment, the promise of fire's limitless, unimpeded growth. This phenomenon, pyrolysis, is the key to understanding the behavior of fire. The goal of fire is to string these pyrolytic moments together for as long as possible, as broadly and intensely as possible. If we have a superpower, besides our brains and thumbs and speech, it's fire. Without its light and its explosive, directable energy, we would not be what we are today. For as long as there have been hearths to gather around, cook over, and see by, fire has been, literally, central to our lives. Virtually everything we humans have accomplished can be traced in direct relation to our ability to focus this fierce energy. Our mastery of fire borders on the magical. With minimal training, we have all become wizards, and our ability to summon fire at will is ancient. There's no other natural force over which we have such a compelling illusion of control. Fire is the only natural disaster that can be initiated by something as casual as dropping a match, and this complicates our relationship to it profoundly. Never in Earth's history have so many fires been ignited in so many places so continuously. Consider every candle, lantern, and cook fire on Earth. Then, every gas stove, furnace, and water heater, every power station, every generator. Already, we're into many billions of fires per day, and that isn't counting matches, lighters, or pilot lights, or more rarefied sources like oil refineries, incinerators, and war. Nor does this tally take into account automobiles. There are well over a billion cars on the road today, a quarter billion trucks, buses, and vans, and 200 million motorcycles. Combustions number in the tens of trillions, each one an individual fire, generating heat, energy, and exhaust. In just the past 100 years, our planet has become a flickering universe of fires. Were they observed by extraterrestrial visitors, humans could be mistaken for a global fire cult. Fire in the wild is a beast, dangerous and unpredictable. It is lightning and lava and forests laid to waste. Oil, on the other hand, is fire brought to heel. It awaits our signal and does our bidding. Or at least, that was the original plan. In all of human history, there has never been a better time to be a fire. We are now almost totally dependent on fire and the products it facilitates for food, shelter, heat, transportation, medicines, and every object we use. Fire, as far as we know, is unique to our planet. A relative newcomer, it has occurred on Earth for about 500 million years. If the planet's history were expressed as a century, fire's presence would occupy only the past decade or so. Fire, to be clear, is not the same as heat, which is abundant in the universe. The sun radiates heat, but it's not on fire in the earthly sense. Earthly fire, our fire, is different. It's not a thing, or a gas, or an element. It is a chemical reaction. But before there was life on Earth, this reaction was not possible. Life, specifically plant life and the oxygen it generates, is the sine qua non for fire. Long before we climbed down from the trees, fire was climbing up into them. Not only would photosynthesis provide the gas required for the first ignitions, its agents, plant life, were storehouses of fuel, hydrocarbons, in the form of wood, stems, leaves, and grasses. Any complex creature that moves does so thanks to oxygen, and the primary reason animals move is to find more food to consume, and ultimately to oxidize, to burn, in the form of energy transmitted to and through their blood. Fire is driven by the same need. In this sense, fire is not an element or a reaction. It's a hunter, just like us. Oxygen is our trail boss, driving us through the world on an endless quest for energy to burn. We are, in fact, oxygen's hostages. If in doubt, don't inhale for 30 seconds and notice how you feel. Suffocation is a grave risk faced by all burners and breathers. Every breath we take staves off imminent death. With this barely conscious rhythm of self-resuscitation, we save our lives about 20,000 times a day. In the first 45 seconds of stifled breath, you will lose your manners, your language, your loyalties, your love, and with them 10 million years of evolution, winding up wide-eyed and flailing, somewhere lower than an ape. In the next 45 seconds, your evolutionary clock will spin back, perhaps 200 million years, until you resemble a lizard, a savage, soulless vehicle for raw impulse, focused with all your being on one crushing need. And in your final seconds, with your lungs ablaze and not a thought left in your head, you might be reduced to something a lot like fire, an appetite for oxygen, the animating gas, with nothing left of yourself but a chemical reaction dying to happen. Our last mortal act is not to move or eat or procreate, but to strip oxygen molecules from our environment. Then, like a smothered fire, we flicker and die. If you look at how humans, undisciplined and unregulated by education or culture, use resources, they tend to consume whatever is available until it's gone. Of course, fire does this too. A key difference between us is that fire has no control over its rate of consumption, but we do, even if it's hard to tell sometimes. Because of this capacity for self-awareness, science has generously named our species Homo sapiens, wise man. However, given the degree to which we are now determined by our relationship to fire and its avatar, the petroleum industry, there's a case to be made for a revision. I propose Homo flagrans, burning man. Since the last days of April 2016, fires had been a throbbing presence on the horizon around the city. This was Fire 009, the ninth substantial fire discovered in the Fort McMurray Fire District that year. 009 was not a day old, but already it was clear that this one was different. Since it was first spotted on Sunday, May 1st, it had increased in size by 500 times. Much of that growth was towards the city, and some preemptive evacuations were ordered. By 10 a.m. on Monday the 2nd, the fire had expanded to 2,000 acres. An hour later, over 3,000. Then it doubled again. Despite the efforts of firefighters, no containment had been achieved. Witnesses described a raging crown fire that sent jet-like whorls of flame spiraling into the smoky sky. The plume was gigantic and plainly visible 80 miles away. Once a wildfire reaches this level of intensity, there will be no further attempts to confront it directly. Instead, the focus is on the flanks and on removing potential fuel in hopes of slowing down its progress. On the evening of May 2nd, Fire 009 did something no fire ought to be doing at that hour. Energized by its own ferocious heat and by winds that should have settled down at dusk, it drove embers across the Athabasca River, where they started a new fire. The width of the Athabasca outside Fort McMurray is a third of a mile. The fire, already within striking distance of the south of the city, now had a beachhead on the north side of the river and ready access to the most densely settled neighborhoods. Even in its nascent stages, it was capable of surmounting any obstacle nature or humans could put in its way. It had now arranged itself in a double-flanked pincer movement. After nightfall, it settled down to wait out the dark, nursing itself on the exceptionally dry ground fuel. Sunrise on May 3rd would be at 5:33. The rest was up to the wind. The forest of Alberta had seen this behavior only once before. In 2001, the story of the Chisholm Fire has attained a legendary status. A senior wildfire expert in Alberta received a call from Washington, D.C. While monitoring global weather data from a satellite feed, the American detected a mysterious aerosol signature in the form of a smoke plume that penetrated the tropopause, the atmospheric barrier containing most earthly emissions, and kept rising far into the stratosphere, topping out at 45,000 feet. The signal was emanating from a sparsely inhabited area in Alberta. Volcanoes are capable of generating this type of high-altitude aerosol signature, but there are no volcanoes in Alberta. The American's question, so the story goes, was, has Canada just detonated a nuclear device? There had been an explosion. Many, in fact. And the energy released was calculated as that of 17 one-megaton hydrogen bombs, or about 4 Hiroshima bombs per minute. This now is what fire is capable of on Earth. The chemistry and physics of fire remain unchanged, and trees are no different than they were 50 years ago, but the air is warmer and the soil drier, enough to make the latent energy, living and dying in these forests, easier to release. The Chisholm Fire set a precedent for the obliterating energy brewing outside Fort McMurray. And at lunchtime on May 3rd, 2016, the energy released there was equivalent to a nuclear explosion. At 10 a.m. on May 4th, 2016, local fire chief Darby Allen gave a press conference in Fort McMurray.
We have successfully evacuated 88,000 people, he said, fighting back tears.
Given the speed of the fire and the infinite variables presented by tens of thousands of human beings all rushing for the same exit in powerful machines, the odds against a 100% successful evacuation were enormous, but no one had been reported missing. Still, he knew they were in for another terrible day. As morning temperatures soared back into record territory, the relative humidity would bottom out at a desertic 12%. Meanwhile, the winds would swing northwest, building and driving the flames back through town. Lightning was also predicted. It was a disastrous forecast.
This fire is a moving animal. There are certainly areas within the city that have not been burned, but this fire will look for them, and it will find them, and it will want to take them.
It was an unusual way to talk about a chemical reaction, and it was at this point that the fire, 4 days old and growing exponentially, completed its transformation to an independent entity with ambitions of its own. Allen wasn't being fanciful. This was how it felt to be in this fire's presence, a hungry adversary, intent on maximum mayhem. It had quadrupled in size since the previous day. It now resembled a gigantic crab traveling northwest with its pincers wrapped around the unburned portions of Fort McMurray. These were proof of the firefighters' success. Roughly 300 firefighters, operating across multiple fronts, often miles apart, in brutal heat, toxic air, and negligible visibility, without rest or reinforcements, had managed to keep the fire out of the city's most populous areas. Grievous as the damage was, there was, on May 4th, still a city left to defend. Whether this would be so at day's end was an open question, and the fire was already preparing an answer, capitalizing on every undefended front and broadcasting embers like incendiary confetti. On its second day inside the city, it was revealing what a truly extraordinary creature it was. Fires tend to follow a pattern. They move fast, wreaking havoc as they go, with the worst over in hours. Fort McMurray was different. It burned with no let-up for days on end, leaving firefighters no time to rest. By the time the newest housing development ignited around midnight on May 4th, it had already been burning as long as the Great Chicago Fire, one of the worst conflagrations of the Petrocene Age. On May 4th and 5th, 2016, desperate battles were still being fought for individual neighborhoods. The fire, which would be described as a siege event, attacked the city from every direction. One reason it was able to do this is because the atmosphere never cooled down. And that's what's different about the 21st century. The highs are certainly higher, but it's the lows, in all seasons, that are in their way more disturbing. A typical spring night in Fort McMurray used to be between 5 and 10 centigrade. In May 2016, nighttime temperatures barely dropped below 20 degrees centigrade. Not only can fire sustain itself much more easily in warm temperatures, but ice, snow, rain, and dew will all melt and evaporate more quickly, making all fuels easier to ignite. Vito Babrauskas is a pioneering physicist and expert on modern house fire behavior. His many works include his 1,000-page Fire Bible Ignition Handbook. I asked if he could explain the physics behind this kind of ultra-rapid combustion scenario.
"That's a difficult question," he replied. "The best analogy is the Hamburg firestorm."
This was the infamous event in which Allied forces studiously and systematically bombed Germany's second-largest city. Over 8 days and nights in summer 1943, bombers dropped thousands of tons of high-explosive and incendiary bombs across the city. Their objective was twofold. The first was physical, to destroy the strategic port, its shipyards, factories, and refineries. The second was psychological. By targeting workers' housing, the raid's architects hoped to kill, terrorize, and demoralize the citizenry, the real engine of the Nazi war machine. A pointedly vengeful military code name was given to the Hamburg bombing campaign, Operation Gomorra. It was diabolical. But this was total war. The 8-day assault on Hamburg would be payback for the equally merciless London Blitz. On the fourth night of Operation Gomorra, 2 million kilograms of bombs and incendiaries were released over Hamburg in under an hour. First were the high explosives. Designed to flatten whatever they landed on, their shock waves blew out windows and doors for hundreds of yards around, while the rubble and craters they made hampered rescue and firefighting efforts. With the buildings broken and ventilated, and escape routes blocked, the incendiaries came next. These were smaller, designed to puncture roof tiles and explode in the upper floors and stairwells of houses. "The bombs," wrote one survivor, "often came to rest in beds or on the floor beside wardrobes, and ignited these fuels, from which the fires then developed." Hamburg on July 27, 1943, was exceptionally hot and dry, conditions similar to those in Fort McMurray. The streets became canyons of fire. stone apartment buildings roaring like blast furnaces. Roads took on the characteristics of giant bellows, drawing in surrounding air with such force and velocity that residents, particularly the lighter women and children, were sucked back into the buildings they tried to escape. Others fled their roasting bunkers, only to become mired in molten road tar, where they too were burned alive. Above the city, smoke and fire spun in a terrible gyre that drew the surrounding air in faster, causing the fire to burn so hot it caused bricks to melt. 20,000 were killed that night. After 8 days of relentless bombing, the death toll rose to 40,000. The bombing of Hamburg would come to be known as the Hiroshima of Germany. But what was the connection to Fort McMurray, which began as a random forest fire? What could it have in common with an unprecedented act of state-sanctioned arson? I saw few similarities other than that in both cases, fires ignited in residential areas under unseasonably hot and dry conditions. But fires don't care if they're set by accident or intention. In the end, all that matters is fuel, weather, and topography. It was this, the driving force behind the Hamburg fires, that got me thinking about Fort McMurray, not in terms of weather, fuel, or topography, but in terms of incendiaries. After all, house and forest fires are relatively common, but what propels them into catastrophic territory? Then I realized, in Fort McMurray, the incendiaries didn't need to be delivered by plane, because they were already there. It's a frightening thought. A literal forest of freestanding 50-foot firebombs. But this is what black spruce are, ready to ignite. With their flammable sap, resinous cones, and pitch-infused wood, you have a naturally occurring incendiary that would impress any war department. Add drought conditions, heat and wind, and you'll get something closer to a blowtorch. In May 2016, it could be said that Fort McMurray bombed itself. With their wind-driven sparks, each burning tree could propagate fires as abundantly as dandelion seeds. By the time this total conflagration system hit Fort McMurray, it was already projecting radiant heat comparable to that experienced in Hamburg. While Hamburg's old houses filled with furniture were extremely flammable, Fort McMurray's modern equivalents were even more so. In addition to their wooden frames, every single house and garage contained a built-in stockpile of petrochemical fuels and accelerants, many of them created by the same companies that manufacture incendiary weapons. Wartime or peacetime, petroleum companies trade in fire. Their products are made from materials capable of burning with great intensity, even if they aren't advertised that way. It raises a grave question. What role does the petroleum industry play in promoting building materials that are supposed to shelter families from harm? The U.S. Army's Chemical Warfare Service had left nothing to chance, right down to analyzing moisture content in the timbers of houses they intended to ignite. In Hamburg, their moisture content was calculated to be between 10 and 15%, matchstick dry, and, as it happened, identical to the relative humidity around Fort McMurray on May 3rd. The fire's assault on the neighborhood of Prospect began in earnest at midnight on May 4th. In order to fight it, firefighters would have to redefine what a house was. These brand new condominiums, suffused with petroleum products and volatile chemicals, were no longer homes. During this all-night battle, the dwellings were approached simply as accelerants, the same way one would approach a can of gas. The past 2 days had been frightening and humiliating, but they had also been instructive, and firefighters were adapting to their new adversary in numerous ways. What was happening to the houses in Prospect had more in common with artificial conflagrations like the Hamburg firestorm than with any homegrown fire.
Prospect was no longer a neighborhood to be saved. It was a liability to be managed. The strategy was radical. Use excavators and bulldozers to cut fire breaks, not through the surrounding forest, which was already in flames, but directly through the neighborhood, removing fuel ahead of the fire. This meant knocking down intact, unburned houses, most of them brand new, by the block, just as a bulldozer would knock down a stand of trees. Flattening the houses would lower the flames dramatically, making them easier to subdue. It's one thing to demolish a house. It is another to demolish an inhabited home. With the exception of invading armies, nobody does this.
Tearing into somebody's house, it's just sad, said Jim Rankin, a backhoe operator who grew up in Fort McMurray. Your house is your life, and you're seeing people's life. You see everything, baby pictures and baby cradles, their couch, their fridge. I could have jumped out and grabbed 10 beers while I was working.
By sunrise on Thursday, May 5th, after 3 days of nonstop assaults on the city, the fire was given a name. It started with Fire Chief Darby Allen, and it stuck.
The beast is still up, he said.
Our atmosphere envelops Earth just as our skin envelops our own bodies. Relative to what they're covering, each of these insulating layers is gossamer thin. This gaseous membrane is all that separates us from the lifeless oblivion of deep space, and neither we nor fire could survive without it. That our atmosphere is malleable and sensitive to changes may be hard to grasp in the abstract, but it's easy in microcosm. If you're traveling in a car and a fellow passenger releases methane, you'll know it in seconds. Likewise, bacon, wood smoke, or roses. The same is true for heat. Arctic bush pilots travel with candles because in the event of a crash, it only takes one or two burning in the fuselage of a small plane to make a night at minus 40 degrees centigrade survivable. Despite the fact that we're protected by a formidable combination of ozone, gravity, solar radiation, magnetic fields, and life-enabling gases, our atmospheric living room remains as fragile as a fishbowl and is easily contaminated. The idea that our atmosphere could be changed by us is something we have never had to consider seriously until a single lifetime ago, which is about as long as we have had to seriously consider the automobile. The Petrocene Age has enabled ordinary people to command energy in ways kings and sultans could only dream of, and with unimaginable ease. Behind the wheel of a Chevy Silverado, a 50-kilogram woman can generate more than 600 horsepower as she draws a 6-ton trailer at 60 miles an hour while talking on the phone and drinking coffee in gym clothes on a frigid winter day. Prior to the Petrocene Age, only a king or a pharaoh could have summoned such power, and its equivalent would have required hundreds of enslaved people and animals. Today, with cheap, plentiful oil at our disposal, everyone's an emperor. As we have harnessed, democratized, and amplified fire on demand, we have also unleashed unintended consequences. A byproduct of becoming a petroleum-based society, in other words, a fire-based society, has been the superheating of the atmosphere. Fort McMurray, founded at the dawn of the Petrocene Age, was an unlikely flashpoint in this collision between the rapid expansion of our fossil fuel burning capacity and the rigid limitations of our atmosphere. Reckoning with the negative aspects of oil and gas is a responsibility that duplicitous marketing, short-term governance, superb engineering, and willful blindness have enabled us to keep at bay for a century. In addition to being extraordinarily flammable, petroleum is lethally toxic, both in liquid and vapor forms. It's almost spooky how comfortable we are traveling with powerful, poisonous bombs positioned directly behind our children's car seats. There's a palpable dissonance between this and the auto industry's recent preoccupation with safety. Exhaust fumes, like the atmosphere they flow into, are mostly invisible and easy to keep out of mind. But if that Silverado's tailpipe were directed back into the vehicle, the driver would be dead in minutes. But somehow, when we run our cars outside, in our shared atmosphere, all the soot and toxic gases magically disappear. When we cast a vote, we believe it will combine with others and add up to something transformative, and it often does, even if we don't like the result. Combustion works the same way. Every fire we light, visible or not, is a vote for the transformative power of carbon dioxide. Every ton of coal, every barrel of oil, every tank of gas is a genie. Once the command is given and fire is summoned forth, CO2 is released and its heat-trapping properties are activated. Once in the atmosphere, it will persist for centuries. Meanwhile, methane, a byproduct of fracking, gas flaring, bitumen processing, livestock raising, heating, and home cooking, remains active in the atmosphere for years after its release. Earth's atmosphere may be huge and invisible, but it is also as finite as a room. Whatever happens in it stays in it. Nothing we make or emit ever truly goes away. This is hard to remember or even believe when we gaze skywards through our domed, transparent ceiling, past our lone moon and lonelier sun, towards the legions of luminous pinpricks beyond it. From our tiny vantage, it's nearly impossible to truly apprehend that we exist inside a closed container. Together with every other living thing and every molecule of our cumulative emissions. And it's even more difficult to accept the possibility that humans could conjure up an insult large and noxious enough to impact the integrity of something so apparently limitless and vast. Even though both the causes and effects of greenhouse gases are as clear as the causes and effects of poor hygiene, many remain surprised by the impacts they are having, while many others cannot or will not accept that human activity plays a leading role. The comparison of manufactured greenhouse gases to personal hygiene is not an arbitrary one. Both are closely tied to the Petrocene age. The first time a Western doctor recognized the connection between hand washing and patient survival was in the mid-19th century, in 1847. In Vienna, obstetrician Ignaz Semmelweis noted that births attended by midwives resulted in fewer infections than those attended by physicians. Then, Semmelweis observed that while doctors handled all manner of sick and septic patients, including cadavers, midwives focused solely on mothers and babies. Semmelweis concluded that the doctor's hands with a one consistent link between sick or dead patients and birthing mothers. Semmelweis broke this link by systematically washing his hands before attending births. The incidence of infection dropped dramatically among his patients, and he made hand washing standard practice. When he tried to persuade other doctors to follow his example, they dismissed him, resulting in the unnecessary deaths of many more mothers and infants. Semmelweis persisted, but his peers ostracized him, and he was forced to leave Vienna. He grew increasingly frustrated, strident, and ultimately irrational. In July 1865, 18 years after discovering the link between hand washing and natal health, he was lured to a Viennese insane asylum where he was beaten and incarcerated. He died 2 weeks later, allegedly from sepsis, resulting from a wound incurred during the beating. He would not be vindicated until the 1880s, when, thanks to breakthroughs made by Koch and Pasteur, germ theory gained acceptance in the larger medical community. Since then, Hand-washing has become second nature to virtually every member of functioning societies around the world. Had hand-washing become politicized, or had there been a profit to be made by encouraging skepticism towards the existence of microbes, public health would look very different today. Prior to 2020, we might have laughed at such a suggestion, but resistance to elementary public health precautions during the coronavirus pandemic offers a real-time example of the individual and societal costs incurred by politicizing science and rejecting solid evidence. Carbon dioxide proliferation is even more preventable than germ spread. The relationship between the heat-trapping properties of carbon dioxide and the warming of our atmosphere was understood in principle decades before Dr. Semmelweis began washing his hands. Trucks, buses, and SUVs are what enabled 90,000 citizens to safely flee the Fort McMurray fires in a matter of hours. And it was the need to fuel such vehicles that brought them there in the first place. There is, in our codependent relationship with petroleum, an element of Stockholm syndrome, and the sight of shiny new $600-a-month pickups, while smoke and flames soared skywards in the background, became an iconic image from this fire. The creative explosion that set this loop in motion represents a segue between the Age of Enlightenment and the Industrial Revolution, both of which were as pivotal for fuel, propulsion, and mass production as they were for art and philosophy. Less well known is how momentous this transitional period was for climate science. Simultaneous with the introduction of the steam engine in the mid-18th century was the dawning awareness that Earth's atmosphere had heat-retaining characteristics analogous to a greenhouse. Solar energy reaches Earth in the form of radiating waves, most of which are reflected back into space. During daylight hours, some of these waves are absorbed by earthly objects, including the oceans, which cool down again at night, and even more so during the winter months, much the way a frying pan heats up on a stove and then cools down after the stove is turned off. But just as a frying pan does not cool all the way down to outdoor temperatures because it's inside an insulated house, the planet does not cool all the way down to the temperature of outer space because it's insulated by our atmosphere, specifically water vapor and carbon dioxide. This is the greenhouse effect, and it's critical to life on Earth. If one were to ascribe a specific date to the dawn of modern climate science, a strong case could be made for August 23, 1856, though its significance went unrecognized for 150 years. Eunice Newton Foote was an artist, inventor, citizen scientist, and early suffragist from upstate New York whose singular contribution to climate science was lost in plain sight until a retired petroleum geologist stumbled over it in 2010. Without knowing it, Foote conducted what could be called the first modern climate change experiment. She used a pair of sealed glass cylinders equipped with thermometers. After filling one with ordinary air and the other with carbon dioxide, Foote took readings at room temperature before exposing them to direct sunlight. While both cylinders heated up, the one filled with CO2 grew twice as hot in a matter of minutes. An atmosphere of that gas would give to our Earth a high temperature, Foote wrote. And if, as some suppose, at one period of its history the air had mixed with it a larger proportion than at present, an increased temperature from its own action must have necessarily resulted. Foote's account of her experiment was presented at the annual meeting of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, where it was read aloud by a male colleague. Attendees would have assumed correctly that her experiment was an investigation into climates of the distant past, a topic of growing interest at the time. Few, if any, could have imagined that they were being given a glimpse of the future, too. Foote's conclusions included an ominous warning that would have gone unnoticed by an audience still inhabiting a horse-drawn, steam-driven world. The receiver containing the gas became itself much heated, very sensibly more so than the other, and on being removed, it was many times as long in cooling.
Humanity is now recreating Eunice Foote's groundbreaking experiment in real time. Only the receiver containing the gas is our atmosphere. If justice is served, May 2021 will be remembered as the beginning of the end of the Petrocene Age. On May 26th, in a stunning conclusion to a historic lawsuit brought by the Dutch chapter of Friends of the Earth and 17,000 co-plaintiffs, the Hague District Court ruled that Shell has a duty of care to cut its emissions to 55% of 2019 levels by 2030. For the first time in history, a court imposed limits of this kind on a private corporation. The exhaustive ruling systematically dismantled and rejected the greenwashing tropes that defense lawyers, petroleum lobbyists, PR hacks, and CEOs have relied on since the 1980s. That Shell will appeal is a certainty, but there is no going back. Plaintiffs have held big emitters to account from various angles, through cases seeking damages and through focusing on a government's duty of care to regulate damaging behavior and protect its citizens. One day after the Shell ruling, a federal court judge made another kind of history in Sydney. "This is the first time," said the 17-year-old plaintiff, Ava Princi, "a court of law anywhere in the world has recognized that a government minister has a duty of care to protect young people from the catastrophic harms of climate change." The case, a class action suit brought by New South Wales high school students who have grown up in the horror of 21st century Australian fire, was based on the law of negligence. It revolved around a permit for a coal mine expansion and the government's duty of care to not further endanger the future of young Australians by enabling the release of more heat-trapping CO2. While the court did not block the mine expansion outright, it did the next best thing. It ordered the Minister for Environment not to cause personal injury to the plaintiffs and their peers when exercising her powers to approve the mine proposal. Judge Mordecai Bromberg issued a blistering statement. "It is difficult to characterize in a single phrase the devastation that evidence presented in this proceeding forecasts for the children. As Australian adults know their country, Australia will be lost and the world as we know it gone as well. The physical environment will be harsher, far more extreme and devastatingly brutal when angry. As for the human experience, quality of life, opportunities to partake in nature's treasures, the capacity to grow and prosper, all will be greatly diminished. Lives will be cut short. Trauma will be far more common, and good health harder to hold and maintain. None of this will be the fault of nature itself. It will largely be inflicted by the inaction of this generation of adults. In what might fairly be described as the greatest intergenerational injustice ever inflicted by one generation of humans upon the next." Dumping the number one waste product of the Petrocene Age into the atmosphere with no restraint has, in one century, become not only the ultimate act of colonization, but the ultimate tragedy. Its impact, the skewing of virtually every planetary system for centuries to come, will be our most enduring legacy. Extinctions will be an inevitable byproduct of this ongoing disruption, a legacy that will go on humankind's permanent record. The 21st century has told us again and again that CO2 cannot and will not be ignored. The years following the Fort McMurray fire have been full of shocking revelations. It's much harder for big oil to plead ignorance or to dissemble its role in manipulating governments and misleading the public about the impacts of industrial CO2. Realizing there was nowhere to hide, Shell's CEO, Ben Van Burden, came right out and said it.
"Yeah, we knew," he told a reporter in 2019. "Everybody knew, and somehow we all ignored it."
The evidence, gathered in the late 70s and early 80s, was already unequivocal. A geochemist who worked on Exxon's early climate research told the New York Times, "We had a significant window, but we squandered the opportunity."
The consequences of this first-degree negligence speak for themselves. For years now, major petroleum producers have been targeted by protesters, and their efforts are having effect globally. In 2019, the head of OPEC, which accounts for about 40% of the world's crude oil production, called climate activists the greatest threat to our industry. Over the past decade, hundreds of university and church endowments, along with city, state, and union pension plans, have pledged to divest their portfolios of fossil fuel stocks. In 2016, the Rockefeller Family Fund, built on the broad back of Standard Oil, announced its own divestment from fossil fuels, in its way, a harbinger of the end of the Petrocene Age. For generations, big oil has been considered a bulletproof investment, beloved by pensions and pensioners alike, and enabled by politicians and governments the world over. As the self-designated keeper of the flame, big oil held the burning world in thrall. In less than a decade, that picture changed. Big oil is still big, but it's carrying debt loads unimaginable in the 2000s, and the cost of exploration and recovery is only growing. In 2021, NextEra, a wind and solar company most people have never heard of, had a greater market capitalization than ExxonMobil. ExxonMobil, the world's most valuable company in 2013, was removed from the Dow Jones Industrial Average Index in 2021. In 2016, such a proposition would have had you laughed off the squash court. Meanwhile, the industry's champions are turning on them. In 2021, Aviva, one of the UK's largest asset managers, promised to deploy its ultimate sanction, liquidating its oil, gas, and mining positions in order to force action on climate. We have an obligation to clients and society to not fund something we believe is catastrophic to the world and capital markets. Truly unnerving to anyone heavily invested in oil and gas is the recent news from the International Energy Agency, a longtime ally of the industry. In 2020, it announced that solar power is now the cheapest electricity in history. Governments are paying attention. In 2021, the European Parliament passed a historic law making Europe's aspirational emissions targets legally binding. By 2030, the European Union must reduce its emissions by 55% from 1990 levels, with net emissions cut to zero by 2050. By mid-June 2016, the Fort McMurray fire was still burning, with 4.5 months of fire season to go. For the firefighters, fire had become a kind of natural state, and as with any long-lasting war, it had found its own rhythm. Fire 009 would not be declared extinguished until August 2017. People familiar with disasters of this kind were astonished by the outcome. The managing director at the Institute for Catastrophic Loss Reduction in Toronto attributed this to sheer grace. How we didn't lose hundreds of people, I don't know. But the fire injured people in other ways, and the toll it took on first responders, on evacuees, on the city, the industry, the forest, the rivers, and the atmosphere is still being assessed. Many of those who fought for Fort McMurray suffer from persistent respiratory problems and know that prolonged exposure to the fire's unrelentingly toxic air has shortened their lives. Many saw the survivors' stories as glimpses of a frightening and aberrant event, and safely far away. In fact, they were messages from the near future and very close to home. Florida, Texas, Oklahoma, Kansas, Nebraska,
California, Colorado, New Mexico, Alaska, Australia, New Zealand, Chile, among many others, had yet to ignite in the alarming and historic ways they soon would. Wherever they live, most people are aware of recent changes in weather and climate, and fire is part of that awareness. Planet Earth's surface is mostly water, but scattered across it is an infinity of fire triangles, large and small. Fuel, weather, topography. From the Victorian neighborhoods of San Francisco, to the seaside villages of Cape Breton, to the pool-dotted suburbs of Canberra, wherever trees, grasses, and human settlement are found together, and even where they're not. Even places we never considered capable of burning, like the Arctic, the Amazon, and the moors of Britain, or that we thought inviolable, like Notre Dame Cathedral, have caught on fire. Thousands of family histories were tragically lost in Fort McMurray. Our collective sanctuaries and memory palaces have entered a new precarity. In August 2018, shortly after a fire tornado tore through Redding, California, I noticed some things easy to overlook in that heartbreaking wreckage. Despite the fact that there was no grass or topsoil, and most surviving trees had been completely denuded of their leaves, there were signs of emergent life. Less than a month after one of the most violent fire events in the history of the continent, new shoots had burst through the scorched hardpan, nourished by the still vital roots of those blackened trees. So out of place were these tender greenlings that they could have been mistaken for plastic plants, but they were real, alive and undeterred. In a place where only stones and twisted metal remained, I saw three amaryllis flowers pushing through the ash. This is reverescence. It's in the nature of nature to do this at every opportunity. Earth's capacity for reverescence is without parallel in the known universe. Again and again it has occurred. For the past 3 billion years, no matter how violent or broad the disruption. That we have become such a disruption grows ever harder to ignore. The consequences of burning millions of years of accumulated fossil energy in a period of decades will be ongoing and dramatic. It will affect everything that matters in more ways than we can imagine for the foreseeable future and probably far longer. The willful and ongoing failure to act on climate science is unforgivable. No recrimination will be sufficient. At the planetary level, there is no justice. The punishment will be shared by all, but most severely by the young, the innocent, and the as yet unborn. In the meantime, life will persist, and so will we. Reverescence, after an assault so brutal, seems like a kind of forgiveness, or even deliverance, not unlike Fort McMurray's miraculous escape on May 3rd. Those trees and people were given another chance. Human beings planted those flowers with no idea what was to come. Devoting our energy and creativity to regeneration and renewal, rather than combustion and consumption, is what nature is modeling for us and inviting us to do.